What problems are troubling you? What's frustrating you, bothering you, worrying you? Want solutions? Want answers? Welcome to Here We Come to Save the Day, hosted by David Adelson. This podcast is dedicated to solving everyday and global problems in an uplifting, fun, enjoyable way. There is a solution to whatever's troubling you. Ask your questions, and we'll do our best to give you practical, useful, workable solutions you can use starting today. Join us now with David's special guest experts who will share their own experiences, life lessons, and practical strategies for creating the life you long for. Start living your best life today, right now, with David Adelson and friends.
Welcome to Here We Come to Save the Day. Today, our guest is Ken Bader, the creator of the B plus C plus S formula. And we're going to hear more about that now. He's going to tell us how to get our employees to want to come to work. I met Ken on stage. He's had me on his show. So before we get to the end, I want to invite people to go to your show as well. So we'll talk about it. Yeah, but first, everybody's anxious to hear how to get their people to want to come to work, especially right now. So you're on.
Yeah. Well, you mentioned the B plus C plus S formula is the foundation for that. In essence, what that stands for is brand, culture, and strategy. In other words, it's simply knowing what is the image we want to promote out in the public, what is the experience we need to create both for and through our employees, and how do we drive more of the right business to our business. And that C, that culture part, that creating the experience for the employees first before looking at the experience for the customers is a critical piece. I have found personally in decades of doing work in different service-based industries with different service-based businesses that it's almost impossible. Every once in a while, I see it pulled off, but it's almost impossible to create a great customer experience without having a positive experience for the employees. And you asked, okay, so how do you create that? How do you make employees want to come to work? The short answer, frankly, is involvement. We talked a lot about employee communication, in the 90s and the early 2000s. And then we went through the Great Recession and people are like, you should just be happy to have a job. Hopefully with this pandemic and the crisis that we're going through now, that we don't get back to that on the back end of this. And then when things got better after the Great Recession, everything was about employee engagement. We went from communication, which was kind of like, we're going to tell our employees exactly what's happening. They may not like it. We don't really care, but they're going to know exactly what's happening. Maybe they're getting screwed in the process and they won't be happy about it, but damn it, they're going to know about it. They're going to know about every piece of it. And then it went to engagement, which is, well, let's make people feel good. Let's go to picnics. Let's, give out awards. Let's make people feel like we're a family. But today, and especially during and after this pandemic, more than any other time, we need to have involvement. And what that looks like in a normal time is, okay, you had a great idea. Here's a budget. Pick your team. As a CEO or business owner, I'm going to let you just run with it. Because people support what they help create. That's what makes most employees want to come back to work. And in today's issues that we're having, even more so. And fortunately, I'm seeing a lot of positive things, such as, okay, your kids have to be home because schools are closed. We're going to set you up to work from home. Normally, a lot of businesses don't want the kids to be around while you're working from home, but this is a unusual situation. We're going to trust you that you're going to be able to not only take care of your kids, but also get the job done. That's involvement. And for all those folks that don't necessarily have kids or people that they need to take care of, this is a great time to show your involvement, to say, I know it's not my job, but I'm great on social media, so I'm going to get involved with communicating on behalf of the business. I'm in sales, and we're probably not necessarily selling right now, but I can do is I can communicate with our customers. Maybe if it's a situation where you can deliver or provide services to people in their homes or other businesses, of course, being safe. Yeah, that's a way to be involved. And that involvement, you know, needs to carry past this pandemic. When you have true involvement, you know, that's creating an environment where your employees actually do want to come to work because they feel like they're part of something and not just simply picking up a paycheck, David.
Yeah, I totally get that. There's some very interesting things that you brought up about that that I want to add to, and we can chat about more. And that is having to do with the experience that I think one of the big things that's going on is people are starting to be honest, I think people are starting to value their own lives. And I think one of the things that's happening with this shift right now that's going on with so many people having to stay at home is they're getting to reevaluate what their priorities are, because the whole concept of we exist to make a profit has left. It doesn't resonate on the world anymore. And so when you're talking about people wanting to be involved, people want if the employer can create an experience for the worker that the worker loves, that you love, that I love, exactly if you're right. If I'm a co-creator in my job, are you kidding? I can't wait to get to work. If you're dictating to me like I'm a prisoner what I'm doing, I feel like a prisoner. So, and I think what's going on, you talked about people, you know, now working with their family at home because that's the requirement of the times. I think it's actually brilliant that nature or God or whoever organized it this way, because people are starting to value what do I want? And the bottom line is, you know, who do I want to be? But what do I want to experience? And now that I've experienced being with my kids, I either want to strangle them or this is the best thing ever or both at different times. So I totally resonate. So is this a program that you offer, teach? You have a book? We didn't cover your bio. I know it'll be in the show notes, but anything you want to bring up that will help people understand why you're an expert in this area, well, we'd appreciate. So why don't you tell me a little bit about you and a little bit about how people can explore this more?
Certainly. I do have a book out there which does discuss the subject of creating an environment where employees actually want to come to work, which in thus creates an environment where customers want to keep coming back. The name of that book is The Formula for Business Success Equals B plus C plus S, thus going back to my B plus C plus S formula. And you could easily find that on Amazon if you type in my name, Kenneth Bator, B-A-T-O-R. There's certainly plenty of content on my website, which is www.btcinc.net. As you mentioned, you know, I had the distinct pleasure to have you on one of my shows, which was Cool Culture Corner. You could find that on Apple Podcasts and Spotify and a lot of fun places. And learn more about this creating an environment for your employee stuff. But you know, I do want to add, you know, things that you can do right now. And I'll give a couple of examples. And it goes back to this whole involvement idea. If you take nothing else from this, it's about involvement, not just engagement and communication with your employees. But I'll give you two examples. One, restaurants are hurting right now, man. And that's one of the industries that I've served for quite a long time. And I'll tell you, you know, if your wait staff, your back of the house staff, yeah, didn't like you as an owner beforehand, you know, odds are, you know, they're going to be looking for ways to reinvent themselves. You know, shout out to Steve Olscher, who is the reinvention king. They're going to look for ways to reinvent themselves. A lot of these folks, you know, had side hustles or aspirations to do other businesses. If they're at home now because they can't work at restaurants, yeah, a lot of them, you know, are looking for new ways to get out of this or to come on the other side of this pandemic, doing something else. So yeah, now's the time, you know, to do whatever you can to involve that staff in terms of, hey, let's do deliveries. Hey, let's do takeout. Let's find a way to brand ourselves properly as a restaurant and maybe deliver food at a really low price or even no cost if you can to the elderly in the community, to the school children that aren't going to be getting meals at school because school's closed. You know, find a way to involve your wait staff, your back of the house staff, to not just, you know, get together as a team, but also to find a way to positively brand yourself, you know, after the pandemic, to be able to say, you know, legitimately, this is what we did during the crisis. And, you know, also I work in the financial sector quite a bit. And, you know, those folks are still kind of running as normal a little bit, although a lot of branches, banks, and credit unions are closed. You know, this is the time to really involve your staff. If you're the CEO or a business owner, you know, you need everybody right now to keep things going. It's all hands on deck. Yeah, this is the time to involve people and say, okay, if we can't have people come into the branches, you know, how can we best serve them? Yes, there's drive-ups, but, you know, sometimes there's documents that need to be signed for loans and things of that nature. You know, what can we best do, either using technology or taking the people that are available to possibly do some home visits to get loan documents and notaries and things of that way done? You know, use this time to either, you know, for the first time, you know, really involve your staff and have that carry over after the crisis, or leverage that up. If you've been really good at involving your employees and making them feel like they are part of the mission, you know, not just fulfilling the mission or grabbing a paycheck, leverage that up and say, all right, yeah, it's all hands on deck. What can we do as a team to keep our business alive and to help everybody internally so that we can help everybody externally during this time of crisis?
So that's very cool. I like the whole point that you're talking about reinventing yourself. And we've been talking about reinventing ourselves from the business owner side. And that's what the purpose of this is the problem we're solving today. But I want to take a shot from way out in left field and just bring up a little something that's an interesting thing to ponder. I actually think, and you kind of touched on this a little bit, Kenneth, is that the people who are now having to work at home or scramble, as you said, maybe they had a side thing, maybe they don't, who are having to reinvent themselves because they're not being allowed to go to work. I mean, we look at teachers, for instance. The schools have shut down all over the place. Harvard shut down. I mean, all of these places have shut down. So, you know, a professor on tenure, he's not worried. He's good. He's getting paid during the summer, that's the way they work out. But if you're looking at a public school teacher, I mean, I don't know what that's all about. But here's something that's an idea. I don't know if you're aware of it. I was told that in Saudi Arabia, where they have so much money from the oil, that everybody gets, I think it's $26,000 a year just for living, just for being there, for being born there. And they'll send you to any school in the world that you want to go to. The only reason I know this is I met somebody who was from there. He told me he was from there. I didn't ask to see his ID or anything. And he was in the States visiting two of his kids, one which was going to school in Berkeley, and then one was going at UCLA or one of the other ones in LA, which is where I met him. And he was just saying that's the way it is. So if you have a family of four, your income is over 100 grand just because you were born there. And so here I'm looking at, and again, this is way out in left field thought. I saw in the news yesterday that the White House or somebody is considering a $1 trillion stimulus package to help get the economy to recover from this. And I'm thinking for a fraction of $1 trillion, you could literally give $1 million to every American. You just give $1 million to every American and the disbursement of that. I'm sorry, if somebody is going to pay more than $20 million for the disbursement of that, they don't know what they're doing. I was going to say something a little more dramatic, but seriously, you should be able to get that done. So for under $400 million, and let me ask you this, A, do you think this would be a good idea? And B, do you think that if people got $1 million, that would stimulate the economy?
Well, I would hope so. I mean, if I got $1 million,
that's places, what would you do?
But if places were open, yeah, I certainly wouldn't shut down my business and what I do because I love what I do. But if places were open, like restaurants and movie theaters and so forth, and it was safe to do so, not only for me and my family, but also for everybody else, I would certainly put that money back into the economy in terms of entertainment and travel. And those are things that my wife and I enjoy doing, so certainly that would happen. You know, I think, too, that I think you kind of alluded to it a little bit, and I think that this is what the government is trying to do. In addition to giving these directives to try and keep everybody safe and get ahead of this pandemic, I think that they're doing whatever they can do, maybe not well at times because government doesn't do this well, it seems like, but to allay fears. Yeah, to basically say, you know, look, we're going to get on the other side of this. Yes, you know, we very well may be in a recession. We are going to have a job problem and so forth. But, you know, we're not going to let that take our nation down, you know, whether it's going to be a direct check to people or what have you. You know, I think that's what they're trying to do. Yeah, I think as an individual, you know, maybe, you know, certainly everybody has a little bit of fear out there. But, you know, I kind of leave it up to my higher power. For me, it's God. For other people, it might be other entities, deities, whatever you want to call it. I don't have the right words for that. But, you know, I've been taught that you worry about today. You do the best you can today. You help out who you can. You know, you move your business forward. And you worry about tomorrow. You leave tomorrow and the next day to the Lord. And you concentrate on what you can do today. I think that those types of phrases ring true right now. And I think, too, you know, going back to, because it all comes back to me, to this B+C+S formula. Yeah, I think that this is a time, especially if you got $1 million and you didn't have to worry about living paycheck to paycheck, if that truly is your situation or will be. Yeah, now's the time to learn. You know, if you really didn't enjoy being a restaurant worker, if you really didn't enjoy working at a bank, if you didn't enjoy being a financial advisor, you just did it because it was going to serve your family, now's the time to do some learning, you know, whatever that is. And I'll give you a case in point. You know, certainly, you know, my business is being affected. I speak all over the country. A lot of that's been shut down. I'm about to postpone a conference that I'm doing in a couple of months. That is certainly affecting my cash flow. But one of the resources that I have is time. And I literally saw on entrepreneur.com, they're giving away, I think, a $2,000 course on digital marketing for $37. So I thought, you know, I could certainly afford $37. And while, you know, I'm certainly a marketing expert, you know, I could always learn more about digital marketing and become, maybe go from a junior expert to a true top end expert, not just marketing overall, but digital. So I think that, you know, some of those folks can take advantage of this time in the proper way to increase and enhance their individual brand so that they can create a different experience and have a different strategy for their career and their future.
Yeah, and I applaud that and I encourage that. And a couple things about it that I want to echo, and that is this idea of reinventing yourself. So many of us, I mean, we see, you know, you see it all the time, is I got the first job I took out of college, and now it's decades later, and I never really liked it. It isn't who I am. It isn't what I want to be doing. But they would promote me every year or 2 years or 6 months or whatever the heck it was, and I was making a living, and I'm tired at the end of the day. And now we're being given a chance to sit down and say, well, if I could do anything and that would help support and help serve others, help take care of my family, if I could do anything that I wanted to be, maybe I want to be an acrobat. Maybe I've developed something, some little widget. You see these great little things that people have developed on, you know, the different Shark Tank type of programs where people come in, they have, and some of these things are amazing and some of them are entertaining, shall we say. But the point is that maybe there's something that you've been longing to do your whole life. And just what you said about this one program about more internet marketing, I think a lot out of compassion and out of recognizing the situation in the world right now, I think a lot of different people and a lot of different, especially in the teaching industries, are now aware that the same thing. We're going to cut you an amazing deal right now so you can, now that you have the time, we realize you may not have the money, but we'll take, you know, we won't make as much or we'll maybe lose a little bit, but right. We can help you. So I want to encourage, you know, what you're saying is if you've been a restaurant worker, if you've been an office worker, if you've been a bank worker, if you've been the clerk in a grocery store, if you've been in a position that you can't go to now because we can't meet in groups of more than 50 people, or you were the cashier at the theater, now's a good time to look into your soul. And if you could do anything, no restrictions, how can you reinvent yourself to be of service to you and your family and others around you? To create, because I don't know whether they're going to give us $1 million. I think it's a great idea, but if they don't, we still have to take care of things. And even if they do, it's a good time to look back and say, am I doing with my life what I want to be doing? Am I having the experiences today, the engagement? Am I getting to be creative? And am I getting to be, you know, exactly your formula? Am I getting to create a me that I'm happy with today, that I'm creating an environment that I am good about creating? Let's do that for a little while. That can only bring good to everybody.
Yeah, I want to add to that real quick. Yeah, much like I think in business for a good period of time, we got on this wild hair path of change, that we had to always embrace change. And I think that, too, during and after the Great Recession, you know, it's all about, okay, you know, reinvent yourself. And that's all great. You know, sometimes businesses do need to change. Sometimes people do need to reinvent. But sometimes, you know, as businesses are rolling along in the right way, sometimes people, and you mentioned teachers, my dad was a successful high school teacher for over 40 years, and he loved it. You know, in fact, today he's retired. And he doesn't miss the bureaucracy, but he misses being in the classroom. He misses the engagement and interaction with the students, you know, to this very day. And he's been retired for, I think, close to 10 years now. But yeah, if you enjoy what you do or you enjoy the business that you're in, you know, there's no need to do a whole 180, you know, but look at, all right, especially in this time, how can we enhance that? You know, maybe if you are a teacher, and I know some of them that are really hurting right now, not necessarily for cash, but some of them are hurting from a standpoint that they miss their kids. They enjoy teaching. You know, now may be the time to use some of the tools that you have. You know, maybe you have some unique ways and exercises of teaching your kids. Maybe that's something that you can go online and create some videos, whether it's for, you know, the students themselves or say, hey, you know what? You know, I've been teaching for 20 years and here are some of the tools and techniques that I've used that have really been successful for me. Maybe an online course teaching the teachers. Maybe there's some things that you could do to continue to do exactly what you love doing because you're good at it, but just simply taking it to the next level. So reinvention is great if that's truly what you need. If you're truly unhappy, then great. Take the time to reinvent your brand and your image. But if you love what you're doing and you have a real skill, this is a great time to take a look at that brand and look and see, you know, how you can create an enhanced brand and create a strategy to be even more than what you were before the pandemic, if that makes sense.
That absolutely makes sense, and I applaud that. I love the idea of teachers coming on and giving courses to teachers, but my, we'll say, mischievous mind also thinks, how about a teacher coming on and telling students how to work through teachers? Because, you know, the truth is that if the teacher could pull you aside the first day and quietly whisper and say, you know, if you do X, Y, and Z, you're going to fly through this course. And if you do Q, R, and W, you're going to be flat on your face on the floor the whole time. So just give you a heads up. You know, this was the kind of thing back in, I don't know if you remember, in the early 80s or 90s, when the One Minute Manager book came out. There was...
Ken Blanchard. Remember that.
Yeah, and he said he was a teacher. And the first day of class, he put on the board all the questions that were going to be on the final. And another teacher walking by said, "Are you kidding? You're telling them what's going to be on the final." And he said, "Not only that," this is Kenneth Blanchard talking, he said, "Not only that, I'm going to spend the rest of the semester giving them the answer." Now, that kind of teacher, even today, is still few and far between. But if you were a teacher and you came on and said to students, "You know, I know you'd rather be on the phone, I know you'd rather be chatting with your friends than this, but if you just played this particular game," wasn't there a program that came out, I want to say in the 80s, which was something about an easy A program you could get, parents all over the place got it, and it taught kids how to interact with the teacher so that they could get an A. And it said things like, simply raise your hand more. If you have a question, raise your hand. If they ask you a question, raise your hand. Even if you don't know the answer, you know, what are the odds that the teacher, there were just all these little hacks, we'd call them hacks today, all these little hacks that you could do that would improve your grade. And I'm not even sure, particularly in this particular little book, it's been a long time, I'm not sure I read all of it, but I'm not even sure it addressed how to actually study or get the answers right. It was more about presentation, that if you act and look a certain way, the teacher's going to be more lenient, grade you, support you, you know, whatever it is. I mean, really in the olden days, you bring an apple to the teacher, but then the other kids make fun of you, but, you know. Yeah. Before, I know we're getting close on time. I really do want to introduce people to your podcast, Kenneth. So maybe you can tell them a couple really quick fun stories from one or the other of them that might entice them to want to listen, because I think you're doing a really good thing there. And I think the listeners to this might want to check you out too. And by the way, I haven't mentioned it yet. All of the links that we've mentioned will be in the show notes. So any link that Kenneth says, or if I say one, it'll be down there before we go. I do want to mention that the Peace and Harmony program that we've developed is playing in the background of this podcast. It generates a small quantum field around you, depending on what kind of speakers or headphones you're using, maybe 4 or 5 feet, maybe bigger if you're blasting it through an auditorium. But that program is free and available to anyone going to peaceandharmonydownload.com. And the biggest thing about it is it reduces family squabbles, less family squabbles if you're playing it, less people grumbling at work if you're playing it at work. So we encourage people to do that at peaceandharmonydownload.com. And now, yeah, let's hear a little bit about your stuff.
Yeah, we definitely need peace and harmony now is more than any other time, if not always. Yeah, you know, to get to Cool Culture Corner, and I will share a quick story. I do want to close the loop on the whole teacher conversation. Is that, yeah, I remember from my high school, ironically, I hated my grade school, but I loved my high school. And I don't remember, you know, too much from the history book or geometry or definitely advanced calculus, which I couldn't stand then and still can't stand now. But one of the things that a number of the teachers taught at our high school, and I heard this from different teachers in different ways, but it was basically, and this is exactly what one teacher said, is the most important thing we're teaching you throughout these 4 years is how to learn. And I think that that's something that, you know, we always need to embrace, you know, going back to the original theme of our conversation, which is creating an environment where employees want to come to work. Yeah, learn how to do that. And one of the best ways to do that is to learn through your employees and, frankly, to learn from podcasts like mine, Cool Culture Corner. We discuss how to better involve our teams for better productivity, better profits, and growth of your business. And there's a number of stories out there. Some of them are just snippets from me, from my book, and things that I've seen from clients and also personal experiences at different businesses. Others are great interviews like the one that we had with you, David, that gives some great subject matter expert angles on creating a better workplace culture. But I'll share this story, which I believe I shared on Cool Culture Corner and also shared on some of my podcast guest interviews, is from a standpoint of involvement, you need to be human. And now is the time more than ever to be human and understanding. I personally don't have kids, but I understand how tough it is for somebody that needs a paycheck, that wants to do the job, and all of a sudden has three kids that were in grade school, now at home for weeks and weeks, maybe months on end, and to try to balance that. You know, as a business owner, as a CEO, we need to understand these challenges of our people. And the number one incident where I really understood that, I used to manage a sales force about 2 decades ago, dating myself not only with my hairline, but also with the story. But I always did one-on-ones with my employees, with my direct reports. And we did an hour, usually once a week. And I would talk about certain objectives that we needed to accomplish for their position specifically. But literally, that lasted about 5 or 10 minutes. And I always told each direct report, this hour is for you. I got a couple things that I usually need to cover, but this is for you, to do your job better. If you need something from me, let's talk about it. If you have a problem with something, let's talk together about solving that problem and not just listening to bitching and whining. And you know what? If you want to share anything personal, you certainly don't have to, but I'm here for you. This hour is for you. Some people actually didn't want to share much, and I said, you know what? Hour is for you. If you want to go and get ahead on some work, that's up to you. Just know that I'm here for you. And again, the one thing that really made me understand the concept of being human and allowing people to want to walk through a wall for you, to really make that connection, is I had my best employee, my best salesperson, who was struggling for a couple weeks, and he came into a one-on-one, and I said, well, how are you doing? Rather than saying, hey, your numbers, are really suck compared to what you had before. I said, how are you doing? Because what I'm seeing isn't usual. So, is something going wrong with you? I'm not as upset about the numbers as I am with the fact that you don't seem like you. So what's going on? And he started crying, and he opened up to the fact that recently found out that his wife was cheating on him with his best friend. I mean, you can't make some of these things up. It sounds like a soap opera, but I'm like, I couldn't even understand exactly what you're going through. And for several one-on-ones for weeks, we talked about it. And I said, are you getting counseling? What are you doing? What are you doing outside of this to get help? I even had pressure from the CEO, who was, a decent guy, but a very ignorant guy, about, why is this guy still here? He hasn't performed in 2 months. I said, don't worry about it. We're working on it. And I got to say, that time, some people may say, boy, did you waste time talking about personal problems. That isn't supposed to be in the workplace. That isn't supposed to be, how you're spending this time and how unproductive that is. Well, once he got on the other side of this, he not only did as well, but better than he did before. And that guy would walk through a friggin' wall for me. We had a project that was just not going anywhere. I needed some help with it. And I said, hey, Pat, Yeah, I know this isn't your direct job, but this needs to get done and just needs to go away. You know, can you help me? He says, boss, this will be done in 24 hours. Sure enough, it was. Because I had made that connection. You know, I had made that human connection. And this time, as hard as this is in this crisis, yeah, this is actually a great opportunity to make an even greater human connection with your employees to where they are going to want to come to work during this crisis to help you and to help everybody and carry that through after this pandemic, because they're going to know, you know, hey, you know what? This business owner, this CEO, this organization was behind me through what might possibly be the worst time in my life. You know, I'm going to walk through a wall for them.
We could have a door in the wall. We don't want to hurt people. But the idea is right that, you know, this whole concept of it's not personal, it's business is just BS, to be perfectly honest, because all business in the long run, really, if you're not touching somebody's heart in a good way and you're walking away with cash, it's going to bite you in the ass somewhere along the way. And I don't know. I'm a big believer in karma. I'm a big believer that what you do comes back to you. When it's going to come back to you, I don't know. I firmly believe you never get away with anything, but that I also believe that the higher power, again, you called it God. We talk about whatever aspect of the divine. Some, you know, you call your father, but your mother calls him husband, and his father calls him son. It's all the same guy. So, you know, you don't really have to get crazy about the term that you use. It's whatever it is,
right.
whatever that great being, intelligence, whatever you want to call it, nature. But it's everywhere. It sees everything, and it's not keeping score maliciously, just as a parent will admire children and not be so harsh on them when they do something very mischievous but incredibly creative. You're both proud of them and furious at them at the same time. But how did you fix that? How did you, how did you figure that out? That's pretty cool, but you can't say that because you're supposed to be, you know, scolding them. But like that, the parent who supports the child and listens and sits down is the one who has a great relationship the whole way. And the parent who, you know, shuts the door, and the same with the employer situation that you just talked about, the same with the husband and wife thing, and the same with the customer to the business relationship. You support me when I'm down, my loyalty increases dramatically. When I have my challenges and you're saying, you know, the employer who says, look, I don't know what's going on with you, but you got to get the numbers up. You know, that doesn't, you know, the first chance that guy has to go to, or woman has to go to be somewhere where they're appreciated, they're jumping ship in a heartbeat. And, you know, maybe they take clients with them. I don't know. But the point is that you use the phrase walk through the wall, whatever it is. The, you know, back in the, I want to say 70s, the Japanese car manufacturers and a lot of the manufacturers, Japan in the 70s was like the best maker of everything. All the electronics were coming out of there. The cars were coming out of there that were just knocking the socks off of the American industries. And one of the rules that they had then is you kept the employee and you took care of the employee regardless of how the business was doing. And if you had a down 3 years, you didn't let people go. You found other ways to cut corners, but you took care of your people, and that had a big impact. I don't know what they're doing now, but that idea and the whole point that you're talking about is you want to create, and I'm going to let you sum up in a second, but from my takeaway is if you support people, people support you. And if you support people as employees, they're going to want to support you, and they'll turn around the same business psychology. If you're cruel to people, it's going to have an impact. There was, I just want to use this one example. There was an entire episode of Patriot Act on Netflix, which is Hasan Minhaj doing his political thing. And his whole thing was all these bad things about Amazon. just ripped it to shreds about this, about this, for about 15, 20 minutes, whatever it was. But then in the end, he says, but I like my two-day delivery, and I like this, and I'm going to keep using them, even though I hate it. And here's the thing that a lot of people have that attitude about Amazon, is they're not happy with it, but they're happy with the service, so they'll use it even though they know all this bad stuff is going on. But the thing is why are they doing the bad stuff? They don't need to. I was talking to somebody actually at New Media Summit, where we were just together a couple of weeks ago, and they talked about Amazon. I don't know if you heard her talk about it, but there was somebody who had registered the domain name, who had bought the domain name AmazonMerchant.com, something like 6 months before Amazon was created. And they were doing great, and they were doing a good business, a brisk business. That I think the impression I got was the guy was doing like $1 million a year or something, which is a good business. And then Amazon came and got big, and they sued the pants off of him. And they effectively put him out of business, which, because she said, you know, the lawyers at Amazon were, if they saw somebody they didn't like, you just take them out, which is what we see in TV shows all the time. But Amazon had enough money. Instead of throwing all that money at lawyers, they could have just walked up to the guy and said, look, you know, we really want to keep our brand particular. How about we give you this much money and you just change your name? They could have done it. They could have played nice. And I bet the dollar figures would not have been substantially different for what it costs them versus what it would have cost them. But the ill will that's created, that's going to come back and bite them in the ass somewhere, somehow, some way. Not my job. I'm not wishing them well. I appreciate their service. My vision would be that suddenly wakes up and realizes that 135 or 165 or whatever billion dollars that realistically he and his kids for like 1,000 generations are never going to be able to spend it. Maybe I could be a nice guy. That would be lovely. I don't know.
Right.
I want to give you a minute to do a recap of anything you think is important. And I want to thank you so much for being on the show. So what are your wonderful, helpful, here we come to save the day, parting words, Kenneth?
You know, it's been wonderful talking to you, David, as always. You know, we've had the pleasure of having a few conversations now. Yeah, you know, your thing on karma in that example from Amazon, you know, it's always going to, those types of things are always going to be a black mark on your brand. So you want to avoid those. If I had to wrap up our conversation and this whole idea of creating an environment where employees want to come to work, I could sum it up in one phrase, and it isn't actually my phrase. I don't remember the author, but it comes from a book called Leadership Matters. And that simply is, people support what they help create. So whether it's now in this time of temporary crisis or during times of more normalcy, involvement, people will support what they help create. And the last thing that I'll mention before I have to go is that I have offered and continue to offer to any guests on any podcast that I'm on is a free complimentary 15-minute strategy session for those folks that may be at home, maybe in the restaurant industry, that are looking at new businesses. You know, that's 15 minutes of talking about, all right, let's hash this out real quick. What can you do with your brand culture strategy? Or those businesses that are looking forward at the other side of the pandemic, how they can improve their brand culture and strategy. Yeah, that's a very valuable complimentary 15 minutes. And they could just simply email me, kbader@btcinc.net. And thank you, David. Love being on your show.
Well, that's a very generous gift. Thank you for being here. Again, all the links will be in the show notes. So if you want to take advantage of this very generous 15 minutes, this man knows what he's talking about. And I'm going to tell you that, you know, people support what they help create. This is what families are about. And at this time where a lot more families are spending more time together, I'm going to encourage you to support each other, to co-create a family culture that you love. Play the Peace and Harmony program to all the time in the house. That'll help keep the small squabbles about unimportant things, it just keeps them from happening. So, Kenneth, so much gratitude for having met you, for being on your show, Cool Culture Corner. And thank you for being on this. And I think this has been very valuable information. And I especially want to encourage people to take advantage of your free 15-minute consultation. I suspect you can be incredibly helpful to people and help point them in a good direction. So thank you again. And you have my full support in all of your endeavors.
Thank you for listening to another helpful, fun, and life-changing episode of Here We Come to Save the Day with David Adelson. To access the show notes and additional resources, go to herewecometosavetheday.com. If you've enjoyed the show and find it helpful and fun, please leave us a review and share with a friend. Tell us issues troubling you or questions you have. We're here to help you. That's what Here We Come to Save the Day is all about. Till next time.